Good evening, folks. We're going to open the meeting at 7:02, 7:03, actually. Alrighty, and we have a full board present, recording secretary, town administrator.
I'm not.
Okay, good.
And we're going to start down the minutes. We're going to go by our agenda tonight. Who wants to do the honors on the first?
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes. What's that? We're doing the budget workshop?
Yeah, well, that was the first meeting.
That's a while ago.
Yeah, I.
Oh, February 7th.
I went to post them on the website and they weren't on the website, so that's when I put it together.
Motion to accept the minutes from February 7th, the budget workshop.
I second.
Discussion?
I.
I had very few changes to make. Alright, then all those in favor?
Aye.
Alright, there's one done. Do we want to do the other one? Go ahead and do the other one?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Make a motion, we accept the minutes of Thursday, February 16th.
Wait a second.
Second.
Alright, any discussion, gentlemen?
Just a minute, that's good.
Okay.
I looked them over, they're pretty good.
Great.
And just then everything was, oh, it's good.
Yeah. Alright, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Do you want to sign now, or sign that way?
Alright, you want to sign that?
I'm going to make a motion that we seal the non-public meetings of Thursday, February 16th at 9:19. I know we probably should have done it right after it came out, but I think we're all dying to get out of here. It was a late night, so that's my motion to seal these meeting minutes. Is there a second?
Second.
Alright, any discussion?
No, this should be appropriate to say.
Absolutely. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. So that's a seal, that's a seal. Now, I'm going to make a motion to approve those minutes. Is there a second approval?
I second approval.
Alright, any discussion?
Nope.
Here and none? Alright, all those in favor to approve these minutes, David?
Aye.
Aye. Try to keep this straight here. I know, as long as we started the minutes, and we, you can be trying to sneak in. I made the motion, he seconded, and I made the motion to approve, and he seconded as well.
We're going to try to confuse her as much as we can.
I know.
Keep you on your toes.
Yes.
Alrighty. Well, we're busy doing the minute signing and the minute shuffle, open up for public comment. Video?
Yeah, is the public going to be allowed to discuss, get in on a discussion with the state reps at this?
That's the intent of the board, but it'll be entirely up to the reps if they so choose. I mean, it's their, you know, because it's their audience with us and it's part of the meeting, but, you know, if you folks are.
It's like keeping informal, we give a public comment and questions.
Okay, that's, I just want to know.
We've got their approval on that, so well, when the time comes, we'll.
That way, I wanted them to know that they can ask questions, that's all.
Well, that was the intent, because they're constituents as well, ours as well as theirs.
Yeah, thank you.
Cool, anything else?
Nope, that's it.
Jeff? Susan? Any other public comment?
Me?
Yeah, you too.
No, I'm sorry. No, I am the public comment.
Oh, I know your name, I can't, thank you. I know it, I just couldn't think of it.
You might want to.
Alright, I'm going to sneak back to Don.
No, I'm fine right now.
Okay. Ma'am, I don't.
Maggie.
I know the face, but you can't put a name with the face, so. Deb?
Not right now.
And someone's behind you, Maggie, yeah.
Bob, right?
Bob. You got anything for public comment?
Not yet.
No? Linda?
Nothing for public comment, but Joe Marie said you need a document notarized this evening?
Yes, it's in the pile here.
Okay.
Let me get to that.
I'm not going to be here for the whole meeting, I've got some catching up to do.
Alright.
Do you want to just sign that one document?
We can do.
We've already done it.
We can do that, but once we close public comment.
Okay, good.
Folks?
Just introduce ourselves?
Well, if you want, well, you can wait till that part, or if you have any public comment, I mean.
No.
Because you're the public too at this point in time.
Yeah.
Alright, we're going to close public comments, and we're going to go slightly out of order because, you know, while you allow our town clerk to do what she needs to do, we have the VES. What was that different?
It's a no-fault.
It's a no-fault. Oh, yeah, well, you've already signed this and approved everything, so it's just basically signing it, so you need to watch me sign it, right?
Yes, that's correct.
It's a signing of milfoil.
The re-signing of the milfoil grant from DES. Okay, so I signed that there. That's what was that being me? Today is the 22nd, right?
Twenty-third.
Twenty-third, thank you. I lost a day somewhere. Oh, two. I'm just doing that. Clean, window. All the shovels. Rolled the balls on paper, I swear. So while you guys are doing that, we're gonna move on to the while you folks are here. All right, folks, we've been fortunate enough that the state reps that represent us are here tonight, and we really appreciate you folks coming. I'd like to try to make this an informal conversation. We already know that they're fine with the public chiming in, and that'd be great. But like any part of the, this is not public comment, so it's all the basically questions and comments from you folks need to come through the board for them, so we're not getting into a running debate amongst each other and such like that. So raise your hand, I'll call on you, and do that sort of thing. Again, like to try to keep it cordial, professional, very informal, and hopefully you can have a great conversation with these folks, and they'll know where we're coming from, in our small town of Dunbarton. So that being the case, thank you for coming. Take it away from there. You go around in the room and do, you know, quick introductions. I'm Brian Pike. I'm the lucky person as the chair of this board. And real quick, I've lived in Dunbarton all my life. I was born here, raised here, except wanted to do the military in UNH, and currently work for the DOT. I run the Bureau of Fuel Distribution. So that's my short spiel. Paul, whichever.
I'm Mike Kaminsky. I'm been appointed to the Selectman Board as of January 1st, and this is all new to me, and it's an interesting learning curve.
And Bob Martell, got elected to the Select Board this year. I don't know if it's where you enjoy the misery or you know, but it's been interesting so far, and I've been a resident of New Hampshire my whole life. Over on the other end of town, Goffstown, grew up in Goffstown and lived in Dunbar, and this was our playground, so it was a nice fit to be living in town. That's my spiel.
So, want to go left or right? It'd be easy.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Bill Cook. I'm one of your state reps. The other two are over here. I live in Bow. I have been in New Hampshire since 1977, but we lived in Amherst, and then we moved to Bow in 2009. So I guess I'm a new guy in town. So, this is my second term as state rep. I do spend a lot of time in Dunbarton, however. I was mentioning to other people, you'll catch me at Page's Country Store. You'll catch me at, it's either Trailside or Heaven's Gas, depending on what day of the week it is. And I'm also a member of Pioneer Sportsman over here. I used to be a director of Pioneer Sportsman, too, so you'll catch me in town. I'm here in Bow with my wife of 49 years. I have a daughter and her husband and three grandkids, two twin boys, 8 years old, and a granddaughter, 11 years old, that go to the Bow school system. And I serve this, as I said, it's my second term, and now I serve on the Science, Technology, and Energy Committee. Last time we met, I was on Public Works and Highways.
Yes.
I remember you and I discussing stuff about
correct,
that.
That's right.
Okay? Well, thank you very much.
I'm over here. I don't have my back to anybody.
There you go.
I know some of you, but for those of you who I don't know, I'm Mary Beth Walls. I'm in my fifth term in the legislature. I've lived 27 years in Bow with my husband, who is just running for his sixth term on the Board of Selectmen in Bow, and currently the chair there, so I'm more than a little familiar with what you guys have to do, because I hear about it all the time. In fact, he texted me late this afternoon, I was sitting in committee meeting, he's like, sorry, I'm not tonight. So, in a meeting unexpectedly, which seems to be happening a lot, as I'm sure it does to you. I have served quite a number of terms on a committee called Children and Family Law, and I am back on that committee this term. I once chaired that committee when we were in the majority. I'm the lone Democrat here. And I also chaired a committee called Local and Regulated Revenues, which, as I said, was the same committee. We had liquor, gambling, and municipal taxes. And because of that experience, I was recently cross-appointed to the Ways and Means Committee, which, for those of you who don't understand the legislature, the Finance Committee spends the money, the Ways and Means Committee raises the money, and they're kind of the two most heavyweight committees, really, in the legislature. So I am stretched a little thin doing two committees with one of them being so ill, but the experience I bring from having chaired Local and Regulated Revenue, I sat hearing all week this week the casino bills and gambling bills, so it was up again today. It's a lot of the same kind of stuff I've learned along the way. So I've been doing public service pretty much my whole life. I have never seriously worked in the private sector. You know, some people might say I like the government tit or something. I just say I like public service. And particularly when you do this job, because as you may or may not know, we don't really get paid. We get $100 a year. So when I've been doing this, this is my ninth year doing it. I'm definitely not doing it for the money. So.
You guys from Bo don't get a lot of mileage either.
No.
Yeah. J.R. Hole, been a Dunbarton resident since 2005. Small business owner. Actually started and run several companies since 99. Currently running an engineering firm with myself and a partner. Doing work in the medical industry. Been a town resident the entire time, moved here from Milford before that. And I've been on Children and Family Law with Representative Waltz when she was chair, and this year I'm on ED&A, and we deal with everything from hair braiding bills today to pension reform.
ED&A is Executive Departments Administration. We don't know the language. And what I forgot to say is I'm actually a trained lawyer, but I have practice in some time.
As a state employee, I recognize Laura, though. Not right now. Well, thank you, and really appreciate you guys coming here. And a big part of the reason why we wanted to is to kind of give you guys a feel for how we are envisioning some of these bills that we're seeing coming across the legislature regarding revenue sharing and revenue for this, because our taxes are going up. And I think the committee that you mentioned. Probably, but, well, Ways and Means, but also the one prior to that, the Municipal Taxation Committee, was probably a good segue as to why we were, you know, asking you guys to come here. We are also missing the State Senator, Scott
Gilbert.
He said he'll be here next week if all goes well, so hopefully we can kind of redo this again with him. It'd be nice if he was here so everybody could hear the same thing at the same time, but yeah, unfortunately he can't make it, so. I guess, you know, to start off the conversation here is, I think the flavor of the board is, you know, we see a lot of cost shifting going on from the legislature to the towns. We're seeing a lot of reduction in revenue sharing, whether it's, you know, ruined meals, whether it's just the plain, this 1969 revenue sharing bill that got axed in 2010, the retirements, you know. That was 2012, I think it was done. You know, I guess it's a bill and they had to take it back to 15% and all that stuff. That's the reason why we're, you know, asking you guys here, because that's the situation at hand for us. And I don't want to sit here and monopolize the conversation, so I'm going to open the floor to the board first and then let the public weigh in.
One thing I found a good tool that we have as selectmen is the Municipal Association. They really monitor what bills are going in front of them. They had a little extract, I wanted to give you each one of them.
I have copies for the public here too.
But just tell us a little bit about what we can do, what you guys can do at the state level to lower our taxes. And those they just highlight a few things in there. That was it's unadulterated. It's just an extract I made today. And I want you to pay attention to that. But there's two bills that really are of concern to me. And one was HB 324, and that's requiring the towns not to put their own valuations on utilities.
Yeah.
And that's a major issue, and that thing is, right now, I understand Representative Cook, it's in your committee now.
We retained it as of January 31st.
And maybe you could kill it for us.
Let me speak to that. The reason I retain it, and I'm learning on this, I'm new on science technology, I took a position to vote to retain, which means we want to study it some more.
Yeah.
Here's the issue the way I understand it. you'll have town A has a phone pole here, and they assess it at $200. Town B, 300 feet across the border, assesses a phone, same phone pole type,
yeah,
at $2,000. That's the issue, and we have lawsuits going on now from Fairpoint, from everybody, saying there's something wrong here. So there was thoughts about taking it to DRA and having them set an assessment, but the people with the $2,000 phone pole are not going to be happy, are they?
But it's like having homes, too. You can have one home on one side of the street at X, and then the other one has a view.
Tell me I'm wrong, but the way I understand it, it's the pole, not the right-of-way. The right-of-way, you can, that's a separate assessment.
There's a number of different things, pole, the wires, strength,
exactly.
You know, the there's a number of things.
So. And the conduits, thank you.
Right, the conduits,
can, so. Can I address this? Because I'm responsible for this.
Absolutely, but please, give me a quick second, if you may,
sure,
before
sorry.
I forget it, because I've, no, if I don't get it out, I'll forget it 2 seconds later. Part of your issue there, you know, I understand you retain everything about going to the DRA, but if we use the DRA numbers, it's been estimated just for Dunbar alone, we'll lose $15 million in valuation, which is a sizable amount of money that those people up there and us sitting here have to take, and yourself as a Dunbar resident will have to pick up and assess everybody in extra taxes.
Yeah.
So the floor is yours.
All I want to do is give you a little history on this, because for years in this state, you could tax electric poles and you couldn't tax telephone poles. Mm-hmm. Okay? Tell me the difference. When you drive down the street, some are owned by the electric company, some by the telephone company, can you tell them apart? Of course not. So what really was going on is the telephone company had a very good lobbyist who used to be my neighbor and vote, lived down the street. At any rate, he stepped aside. And then I got to be chair of local regulated revenues, and I hated it. I always hated that disparity. And I got it through my committee that they could tax telephone poles as well. So since then, they've been taxed. So this fight over the valuation has started since you can tax telephone poles in addition to electric poles, because, and it's poles and conduits, by the way, it's both, because a lot of the stuff is buried.
Yes.
So that's where this started. You're right, it's gone through the courts. I believe it's before the Supreme Court, and I'm glad you guys retained it, or you could have killed it, because I think, realistically, we've got to wait and let the Supreme Court rule. And given that I think the case has been heard, I think you're just awaiting a decision on it, I think that's probably the best thing. And I think there's a good chance the Supreme Court will resolve this without the legislature having to go there. But that's the history as to how it got there. He explained why somebody put the bill in. I was opposed to the bill for a whole lot of reasons, even in addition to the poles, because it applies to more than the telephone poles. It applies to all kinds of utility property.
Yes.
Including things like the Merrimack Power Station,
which
is a huge issue. And the state DRA's assessment of the Merrimack Power Station is substantially below what we assess it at. So that bill was going to be a disaster for all three of us, for our constituents. So I would have opposed that bill no matter what, just based on that kind of thing alone. So that bill, I think, is like many bills often do, had unintended consequences.
Yep.
It may have started on utility poles, but it was written so broadly, it was going to affect things I think people didn't intend it to affect.
Well, it's on our radar.
Yeah. So just...
Well, you can get a chance to weigh in on it, too.
When you have someone like the state or something else, I'm not saying that Senate Bill 324 is correct, as an independent outside firm that sets the valuation, you don't run into the issue Bo's facing right now, where the town assessed the Merrimack Power Station at one level, substantially different than what it was rated outside, and they're facing something north of a $6 million difference in terms of evaluation over a number of years, which is going to come back in the next couple of years in terms of a huge tax increase, because effectively the ratepayers have been paying a large portion of the Bo property taxes for a number of years. So there is something of value, right, as an independent group making the determination. However that's done, right, that kind of levels the playing field, so it's not the town versus the utility or the town versus the telephone company, right? At least in this case, it's an outside party, and everybody, whether it's the state or some other group, they can point the fingers, that's the group who messed it up. But if it's been done uniformly, it will potentially resolve these $6 million dilemmas that we're looking at for Bo.
Which is on appeal to the Supreme Court as well. That case, they lost the case at the trial level of Bo, and it's on appeal to the courts.
Okay, I'll move this along. I think it's, a second bill that I was concerned with is House Bill 413.
Can I just say, Mike, after having heard 9,000 bills, I have no idea what the numbers
okay.
are. You just got to tell me what they are.
This is about, it's one that basically restores a 15% state contribution to the retirement system.
And you passed it out of committee?
It came out of committee.
And did it pass the floor yet?
It passed the floor, headed to the floor. So just this, a little bit of history for those in the room, right? This, at one point, when the state encouraged towns to put people into or allow them to participate in the New Hampshire employment system, they encouraged.
Required.
Well, there was a carrot and a stick, but part of the carrot of that was that the state was going to chip in money at the time.
Exactly.
And they have slowly eaten away at that over decades, and it is no longer anything. This bill would restore 15% of that contribution back in, and it's currently in finance, and the issue is it's an $80 million shortfall in the budget, and they're trying to figure out where to.
At one point, it was the state was paying up to 35%. They dropped it almost to zero, and now they're
2-0. Almost about it. They took it to zero in 2011.
And now the bill is asking for 15% restoration. And the thing is, I'd like to thank Representative Cook and Representative Wallace for supporting and voting for it, and Representative Hull. I just would ask you to reconsider it as it goes through the budgeting process, because that impacts what we pay for employees.
I understand. But we can't just write checks. The money has to be in the bank.
And it's got to be in the budgeting process. Right. And I think the municipalities are looking at, even if it's 5%, but there's got to be a number in there which is amenable to everybody.
Fair enough, right? It was, the bill before me was 15%,
right,
and $80 million this budget, and it wasn't in the budget anywhere.
Right.
I mean, no one wants to pay taxes. I mean, I'll give you that. I mean, if anybody wants to pay taxes, they're not right. However, we all have to take, we got to pay our bills, our obligations, and I think, that's incumbent upon, unfortunately, you guys in the legislature to find the money to do that, however we do it.
Right. Yeah, because over the past several years, probably more than several years, a couple of decades, it's slashed the way of revenue sharing, it's slashed the way of rooms and meals tax, the amount that the towns would and the municipalities would receive. So they found these mechanisms in which to enrich the state side of the budget by digging in the same pocket that we use to pay property taxes with. So that's a concern. And there's one other issue that I hear scuttlebutt about, but I'm not sure. And I think maybe I think I'll refrain, because I think I'll see if the school board weighs in on it.
Okay, fair enough.
So.
Yes, I'm with the school board. I know one of my big pet peeves is flood control. I know you guys deal with that. Our town gave up a sizable amount of land to take and help out the public safety, everybody downriver. The state of Massachusetts hasn't been paying their bill, and until recently, the state of Hampshire really hasn't been paying their bill either. And again, that's money out of our pockets for, being kind and generous, public thinking people here in Dunbarton and surrounding towns like Cooks, Hopkinton and Ware and such. So you guys can find a way to fully fund the flood control, or either force Massachusetts into it.
That'd
be very helpful.
Please.
So there's an example, right, where we gave up north of 1,000 acres or something, a significant portion, and if you look at our population density, the total cost per person is actually much higher than some of the other surrounding communities.
Yes.
And you're right. There was, at various times over the last 6 years, that I've seen efforts to try and get that reestablished and to have the state be the one who goes after Massachusetts, because it's really hard for a local municipality to take them to court.
Right. Well, I think the agreement was with New Hampshire, and Mass and New Hampshire overall.
It is.
And Army Corps of Engineers was all part of that parcel. So, I mean, there's a number of parties, but unfortunately, it's us that are feeling the brunt of it over the last probably decade or so, as it's been dwindling away, and at some point, so it's nothing by either state.
Can I just address that?
Absolutely.
Because I was involved in that too. Stick around long enough, you get your fingers in lots of things. But so in the 13-14 term, let me go back up. In the 2011 and 12 term under Speaker O'Brien, they zeroed out that money to you guys. You got nothing in flood control. They took the money from Massachusetts, said it's ours, and didn't share it with any of the towns. You guys started rightfully screaming about it. So, and I wasn't in that term. So the following term I come back, which is the 12, 13, 14 term.
And that came up in the finance committee, and I followed it in finance. I wasn't on finance, but I sat in there and went head to head with Neil Kirk about getting the money back.
He lives in where, too?
He does live in where, and Neil was not giving it to you guys, in all honesty. If you really want to fight with somebody, and I'll, today the person you still need to fight with is Neil, because he's once again chairman of the finance committee, and they're going to be the ones that decide whether or not you get the money. So the best I could get going with Neil, and I sat there over and over again in finance on it, the best I could get out of Neil was you were getting the money for the current term. I think you should have gotten the money for the last 2 years when I was out of the legislature. They wouldn't give you the money under the O'Brien term, and they were giving you money from prior to O'Brien that they'd been withholding. Mm-hmm. So you got everything except for the 2 years that the Bill O'Brien leadership stole from you guys. Everything else, we got you in that term. I remember the deal that we just couldn't get 100%, but we got all but one biennium of money to you.
I thought there was some money, and I may be wrong, but I thought Massachusetts coughed up some money, and they retained some of it in the general fund and then paid us a portion of it. That same time. So
you could be right, but I thought we were paying you everything we owed you at that point.
2 or 3 years ago.
But you could be right. And but when I was there in those years, in 13, 14, fighting with Neil, the deal was they told us that we were getting, you guys were getting everything except for that one biennium of 11, 12. They were going to hang onto that money. That money was already spent. It had been spent for the general fund, and they didn't really have it. And you're right.
It wasn't theirs to spend.
It wasn't theirs to spend. I absolutely agree with you, which is why I went. And, you know, I was the only one from this district in there fighting with you, and I sat there until the bitter end trying to get that money for you guys, and that's what we could get out of there, and I couldn't get any more. But in all seriousness, go to Neil Kirk, because you're going to face that fight again, and it's in Neil's purview, and Neil needs to be hearing from people, because that's who's going to make the decision.
That's good to know.
Because that's not just the revenue they lose from the land that could be flooded, but as I have a piece of land there that has an easement line where they can hold back water to that easement line. So what happens is my property taxes get adjusted because there's an easement line there. And I don't know how many other people in that area are under the same situation, but it costs everyone in town money to make up the difference for what I don't pay and what others don't pay.
Can we move that easement line?
There's going to be more land.
Well, that's good to know about, especially Neil.
Do you know Neil?
I've had conversations with him over the course of time.
I'll
leave it at that.
Speaking of bills that directly affect our taxes, there's one in finance right now that Bates put in. It's House Bill 354, right? And it potentially would reimburse us for the difference in disparity aid that wasn't sent our way over a number of years to the tune of almost $150,000.
You're talking about school aid or
school aid?
School aid, right.
It's a big deal, and it's worthwhile getting whatever help we get to get that through.
Now, is that in result from the Dover lawsuit?
Well, this is a long conversation, but it's there was a point where we were trying to shift from one funding formula to another, and to do that transition, they kind of set a framework in place that said, here's the minimum you're going to pay, and certain towns that had increasing populations, like Dunbarton, lost out on that.
We have members of the school board here if they'd like to comment in. Yes, sir.
Yeah, we're already including that money in our projected revenues for next year.
Okay.
We've been told it should be coming out.
Can you announce where you are so these people
can
know you?
Yes. Jeff Trexler.
Yep.
I'm on the school board. About $146,000.
Yep.
We're not sure if it's going to come in this school year, and then it would be part of our unencumbered fund balance to offset taxes next year, or if it'll be part of our additional education grant that we get in the next fiscal year. We're not sure where, but we've been told it's coming, so we're budgeting for it. Keep it coming.
Trying.
Keep it coming.
If you guys have anything else, you guys have been very nicely quiet out there, but I mean, by all means, if you have questions, concerns, I mean, you know, we can have the whole conversation here, so. It's open. Jeff?
Yeah. Okay, yeah, I'll get my hand up in here again. You mentioned about pension reform, and you know, we also have to look at the big broad picture, and that is we've got a lot, our population's declining, The number of kids in our school system is declining. The number of teachers we're going to need is declining. Yet our pension promises to our retirees is continuing to go up. We're going to have fewer and fewer teachers contributing. Our entire New Hampshire retirement system is going to be in jeopardy, not too far off. So we're talking about the state perhaps restoring some of the funding to the town. The state also needs to look at the long-term health of that whole program. And what are we going to do about it? Just like Social Security, nobody's talking about what the heck are we going to do about fixing this problem that we can all see, we can all do the math, but yet nobody's taking the steps to take care of it. So that's an issue I'm concerned about.
I totally agree with that situation. I know a big part of it that I see, especially as a state employee, is a lot of times you have retirees come back into their old position, work part-time there. So every time you do that, you're taking money out of the corpus of the account, of the pension, account, because you don't have an actual position there contributing to it as well as the state contributing on their behalf. So the unfunded liability continues to inch up.
I was going to say, those part-timers that work, mm-hmm. 30 or 32 hours and no more,
yep.
They currently do not contribute to the retirement system.
And the state is 29 and a half because of the Affordable Care Act and all that stuff. That's okay. Where they drove the line as 29 and a half for part-timers for the state system.
Well, there's currently a bill before the legislature that I think has...
It was in my committee today and it passed with a significant modification.
You're the one to make them contribute to the retirement account.
Yes.
So
I can summarize it. I can't give you the language.
Was it 542, 543, or 561?
561 was the final bill. The other two got retained or ITL'd.
That's right.
All of the information got moved. That was important. Got moved to 561. 561 basically said, if you decide to replace a full-time person with any sort of part-time person, right, temporary, interim, whatever, however you want it, okay, within the first 12 months of that position, you then owe the retirement dues for that part-time person. If there's a 12-month lag, and this was what the committee worked out, between when you decide to end this position and restart it.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say we create the assistant of the assistant to the road agent or something, right? Some theoretical position.
Yep.
And we have it as a full-time position, and then it goes away for 12 months and one day. If you hire a part-time at that person, there is no contribution. It's only if you try and do a replacement within the first 12 months.
That was a compromise of the fact that as people do take and leave and you change positions from full to part-time all the time.
Right.
For whatever reason.
Right.
Okay.
Do you support the compromise?
I did.
Good.
Yes. Goalie and I work.
So hopefully that will help.
It's little pieces. There was also a bill in versus... those who were in group one and those who were in group two, and it wanted that Department of Corrections people, various even clerical functions into group two, and that's kind of potentially a disservice to those who are already in group two.
Mm-hmm.
So that bill did not get moved forward. I think that would have actually made pension liability worse, not better.
Yes, because they have a whole different
structure.
Criteria.
Yep.
Taken into
attached.
They
missed 10 years earlier.
Yeah. And they also, group one also gets Social Security, group two doesn't normally get Social Security when they take them, so that's why their contributions are so much higher.
Right.
So, I know, her name, I can't think of it off the top of my head, but she did her dissertation on her PhD dissertation on the retirement system. And she used to be the director for Bureau of Education and Training.
Yeah.
Her first name. I can't think of it. That's why. But she's a very sharp person. Learned a lot from her about the retirement system. So, anything you can do to fix it. I know you have a bill in there for amortization rates, I think, to change from 30 year to 40 year. It's,
Advertising what?
No, amortization. House Bill 369 changes the amortization of the retirement system from 30 years to 40 years to the unfunded liability.
Yes,
it lowers the rates initially, helps us out with that, but unfortunately it adds more time and more money in the long run.
I think that bill's been killed already. And
oh, good.
For anybody who studies math, the idea of taking, instead of a 30-year note on a mortgage, right, a 40-year note, that means the first 25 years you're doing nothing but paying interest. It's a really bad plug.
That math
doesn't work. That's really kicking the can down the road, so yes.
Good.
Phew. I'm pretty certain that one's dead. You said 369?
Yeah, 369. I made a few notes. Retirement's near and dear to my heart. So, anybody else out there wanna get some thoughts? Deb?
I'd like to...
Can you just answer your name?
Deb Foster. I would like to hear from all of you about your thoughts on the building aid bill that's in the Senate, right? That's going through the Senate about something about heating and water systems, which is a little different than building aid. Actually, you're not senator, so that probably doesn't apply.
Well, they will at some point.
Well, unless it's killed.
Yeah.
It's not just building aid for the buildings, it sounds like it's for heating and the water system, so...
Do you know the bill number?
Yeah, 105.
Isn't there also a requirement on that that's gonna deal with needy towns get the money before better off towns? And if that's the case, you guys won't see it.
Right.
Right.
So I think, last time I heard the discussion in the Senate was to try and eliminate the needs basis for that. Whether it's gonna survive, I don't know. I think, you know, we're not as tuned in as to what they're doing on those things over there. I kinda wait and see what comes to us.
So it has to come, okay. The other...
The crossover day is all April 6th, and we get it April 6th.
So in the House, I wanna know what your feelings are about supporting full day kindergarten. I hear, you know, there is that bill out to be considered. Also helping, I mean, this, we have a full day kindergarten in Dunbar, and we're not being compensated for full child, half a child. So this bill apparently is written so that you will, if it passes, we could get full day and not targeted, but every town getting it. So what are your thoughts or feelings on how that?
I ran on it. If you remember my campaign literature, it's one of the platforms I ran on that I support full day kindergarten when nobody else in this district can.
So what is the feelings now?
I support it still. We should fund it.
You support it.
The governor has it in his budget, hasn't he?
But it's targeted.
Yeah, but the governor's budget, I'm working on this. The governor has underfunded his budget in a lot of ways. The governor's playing games with the money. He's put stuff in there he doesn't have the money for.
Well, let's see. We have full-time kindergarten, as you know.
So what are
you going to find it by without...
I mean, that's going to offset, how that's going to help the tax rate in Dunbar and Bo.
Well, if it's targeted, Bo's not getting any money.
Well, right.
Neither are you.
But well, and...
But that doesn't make, is that fair? So what are your thoughts on?
So, at a high level, the $14 million, I think, was roughly what the governor put into the budget to start with, does not fully fund kindergarten throughout the state. So, hence the term targeted. For the record, I homeschool four kids. We could put four kids into the school system here. It would cost us more than, right? That would be a significant increase in the costs for the town. So, I'm a proponent of some other options. I have always been a proponent for private kindergarten as opposed to public. So, I see there's real value there. And we have to, by allowing kindergarten in Dunbar, we've effectively killed the Montessori kindergarten and the other ones in the area. I'm not sure that's a good thing.
Well,
Deb, can I chip in on that?
Actually, no, I can't. Until you get permission.
Right.
Go ahead, Jeff.
Thank you.
I just want to make sure you just keep it coming through the board.
I understand. I was on our all-day kindergarten committee last year, where we studied this issue before we brought all-day kindergarten to the voters. And kindergarten is not like what kindergarten used to be. And the problem we had here in Dunbarton was the kids who would show up for first grade, we'd get maybe 10 out of our half-day kindergarten program, but then there'd be another 10 or so that came from a private all-day kindergarten, and there was such a disparity between those groups that it took our first grade class quite a while before they could get everybody up to where everybody's moving ahead. And then we have kids who didn't go to any kindergarten. They're at grandma's house. So we saw this as an equity issue. And the problem is that not everybody can afford private kindergarten to get that really good start. The public all-day kindergarten is working great this year, but yet we're only getting half the revenue. We're only getting $1,818 per kid instead of $3,636 per kid. If we got that additional money here in Dunbarton, that'd be, what do we have this year, 20?
35.
We have 35 this year. That's about $63,000 in additional revenue we've had here, which is 20 cents on our tax rate. I mean, it really makes a difference here in Dunbar, and we really see the value. I really see the value, having studied it, of all-day kindergarten in the public setting.
I mean, JR is from Dunbar, so he understands what you probably know the demographics. We have no real business commercial zone, industrial zone, anything to take and use as part of our tax base. We unfortunately are just strictly residential, and as you know, 9 times out of 10, a house is going to be more costly than the amount of taxes you get out of it to take and, you know, for the services that they're provided, whether it's school, police, fire, you name it. So unlike the business where it just sits there at night and just
school
exists.
School in particular, right? I mean, that's the...
Primarily school, yes. And now that we're going to the Bow school system, houses seem to be selling quite well here.
They are.
And that being the case, I have to tend to agree with Jeff. I mean, anything we can get for revenue to help out our tax base, because it's basically, for every $100,000, it's 33 cents on the tax rate. We could use it to help everybody out here. So, because we don't have business like the Bow Plant to help us out, you know. So,
yeah. On that same topic, there's a couple of bills that I'm not sure what they mean. They're house bills. One of them is a savings account, education savings account.
Yeah, that's been retained. It's not going anywhere. Yeah. That's Mary Guile's bill.
That, what was that?
Mary Stewart Guile had that bill in. And she's been working on that for years, and I know it got retained.
What does that mean?
It means they're not going to do anything with it this year. They'll deal with it next year.
But what is it? What is it?
I don't exactly remember. I remember it.
Well, sounds like a health savings account, but for education.
But
that's essentially what it was, yeah.
But why?
Turn it over.
Why not? Why did they retain it? I don't know.
No, why have it in the first place? What was the reason for it?
Yeah, that's a sponsor, probably. Okay.
I didn't know if you would...
I think you're right. I think it was a vehicle for saving, for another vehicle for saving for education.
Well, I have a Senate Bill 193 for...
No,
this was a House Bill... The one I saw was House Bill 647. It was saving account for children with disabilities.
That one passed, I believe.
So how is that different from what we already cover with special needs and the federal required mandate that we cover and supply? Why would we be doing this?
I believe it passed. It's not showing as passed. It's showing as in committee.
But what does it mean?
I believe this was setting up the availability for disabled kids to put some portion of funds into an account that they would have, the parents would have discretion on how that account is spent.
Would they already get support?
This was for extra services. There was a list of extra services.
Would they already get extra services?
This was a list of extra services.
So would it eventually come to the full house?
It will come to, yeah. So, for those who don't know, New Hampshire's not like all the other states. In all the other states, you can kill legislation in committee. It's really, right? New Hampshire has this, and goes back for like 30 years. Yeah. Any bill that gets submitted goes to the floor at some point. Like the retained bills don't go to the floor this year, but they're all going to show up in January next year in one form or another. So every bill goes to the full floor. So
yeah,
there is a chance for
one way or the other.
Yeah.
So that means that money is being proposed that will not come to this public schools?
I'd have to look at how the funding is, whether it's going to the local schools or it's going to a third party, I don't know.
But it's money that will not be spent towards public education?
It would be, well, no, because there's a list of, including public education, of where it could be spent, right? Outside resources, tutors and things, was on the list.
I think this deserves a little more
study
on it. Yeah,
I didn't know if you knew about it. Okay.
All right. Anything else, though? I know Jeff has been chomping.
No, it's okay. I'll pass. Keep going.
Hold on. So I just want to let her finish.
Okay. The school building aid went to zero for a long time, mm-hmm. and now there's talk of bringing it back, but not fully. So that's another thing that would offset, help Dunbarton when getting ready to for the future building of the school. It's going to cost the town. And so, you know, we used to have building aid as an option, and it sounds like it's no longer going to be an option. And so I was wondering or hoping that could be...
It's kind of like bridge aid, too.
We have the problem both.
I suspect that with the backlog of money that is of projects that were put on hold and or were started, any potential building aid will be consumed by that backlog before they start any new projects.
Before they start?
Yes.
building it up again for everybody.
Before they start making it available for projects going forward, the backlog is still there, so I would not count on that money. That would be, I mean, it'd be nice, it would be a nice thing to count on, but that would be an unwise.
But it's gonna be in the direction of actually reinstating it now, so it will be.
I believe it was for prior projects, yes. No, but they have a backlog of projects.
No, I know, but the whole program is not gonna be killed like it was before when it went to zero.
I can't speak for how finance will come up, what will come out of the end of that pot.
The current legislature can't take and handcuff a future legislature, so they could take. Jeff?
So, on the building aids, my understanding, because we've looked into this, we're looking at about $1.9 million of improvements over at the school in 2018. So this is really important to us. There is a building aid program. It's targeted, if you will. It's based on need. There's a lot of criteria that goes into ranking projects, but the legislature hasn't put any money into the funding. So that's got to be the first step. You got to start putting money into the funding if there's going to be any kind of chance of us getting some building. And a lot of it's going to depend on whether, you know, which communities happen to pass a project and which don't. You know, if we happen to pass a big project and other communities don't, we may rank higher and may get some money out of it. We used to get 30%. You know, and that's a lot of money for this little town of Dunbarton. And it really helps our tax rate.
I'll let somebody else come. I just want to say, I looked up Mary's bill. I'm not sure it's going to hit. Establishing Children's Savings Account Program?
Yes.
Okay, I've got it. It's House Bill 609, for those of you trying to look. Establish a Children's Savings Account Program, which will be available to any student enrolled in a public or chartered school program and who completes a financial literacy program. So it's basically, it sounds like just straight up savings account, and increases registration fee on mutual funds. Oh, that's how they're going to pay for it. They were going to increase the registration fee on mutual funds offered for sale in the state. So I remember Mary talking about this, and she's been working on this for years. And the short version is, it has nothing to do with money that you're going to get from the state
for the
schools.
For the adequacy grants.
Right.
That.
It has
won't
nothing
take,
to do with
take
it.
Away from that.
This was just simply an independent way for to save money for other forms of education.
Okay.
So, and I know Mary, she would never steal, from she would never put a bill in that would take money from public school.
Okay.
She's a former chair of education.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I heard some of the talking heads on the radio talking about that bill, how they're going to sink the mutual fund industry for investors.
Yeah,
so there's pros and cons of that bill.
Yeah.
It
wasn't that much. I was pennies on the mutual fund. It was a tiny amount, but even pennies is controversial in our budget.
Reason on gas tax.
So there's a bill that we just passed out instead of doing the gas tax, and it came out of Ways and Means. I can't remember if it's got on the floor yet now. That's going to increase, there will be a surcharge on cars depending on the mileage you get. So if you get under 22 miles per gallon, you're not going to pay anything. If you're driving an electric car, I think you're going to pay $125 a year. And everything in between. It was set up by mileage along the way. Because they're not going to get a gas tax increase through, but...
Did we table that?
We tabled it or killed it.
We tabled it.
Yeah. I'm losing track.
Yeah. I have a hybrid. I was totally against that bill.
That bill was a way to, in lieu of the gas tax increase, I guess instead. But it was a way to say we need more money for the roads. And people who are using the roads and not paying it through the gas tax, it was a way to try and tap into that.
They've been losing a substantial amount of millions of dollars every year because of fuel efficiency and the
exactly,
highway
and that's what that was trying
to
address.
But my argument was, hey, I'm being a nice guy, I'm going out buying this hybrid car, I paid $4,000 more for it, saving the trees, now you're going to penalize me for doing it?
I understand, but then again, your car is creating the same amount of damage as my car that doesn't get that mileage.
And, you know, and that's exactly right. It should be on miles, not on how many miles per gallon.
No, mileage, not miles driven, but I mean, just, you know, we could drive the exact 10,000 miles exactly the same. My car weighs the same amount as yours does. You just get better gas mileage than my car?
Correct.
You're doing the exact same amount of damage to the road as my car is, but yet... I'm paying
more. No, I understand,
the road,
but then we should tax based upon mileage.
That's a
not miles per gallon.
Oregon's doing that as a test. There's many different ways.
He or she who uses it should pay for it. I mean, I'm for that.
Again, that's, you know, I don't envy your jobs. I mean, that's something you guys find a way. That is your job, son.
Well, it's...
Like, our job is to take and pay our needs to you.
It's always nice to find money out of state.
Absolutely.
And the issue, so I hate talking about that.
Yeah.
But the idea of taxing mileage sounds really good at first, right? Where you're gonna, you drove 2,000 miles, you get taxed at this rate. You go, drove 20,000, it's 10 times that. Well, that's great. Unfortunately, it means we no longer tax the people in Mass who drive through here up to their vacation homes and spend their time here, who buy gas here. And that number was real.
Yep.
So they didn't want to give up all of the out-of-staters who were buying gas here when they looked at that policy.
Okay.
So
Well, let's raise the gas tax.
Well,
I think I'm the only one of these three that would raise the gas
tax
again.
Yeah,
probably. I put a toll booth on
every road along
the border.
Too many roads and bridges.
Yeah, well, it's not a horrible idea because, I mean, if you're using the road, you're going to pay whether you're out of state or in state.
There you go.
I do understand that coming.
You got to think sometimes outside the box. It probably won't fly, but
no.
You know, maybe there's some.
It's
just,
expensive.
They couldn't get, they tried, and they couldn't get another gas tax increase, too, so that's why.
Bob?
I think you should raise the gas tax because
Bob Ray, thank you.
Dunbar Management Committee. I think that you should raise the gas tax because that's the only mechanism that's going to force people to give up their large trucks that consume a hell of a lot of gas and are heavy, and that contributes to your weight of and how much they beat up the roads. New Prius is not very heavy, and compare that to one of those big honking trucks that ride around here all the time. They deserve a little more pay for their gas, and that'll help fund the roads. In all honesty, if...
No, go ahead. I'm just telling Margaret. I see her.
If you raise the gas tax, at least it's more equitable because the person that's getting more mileage with their car isn't using as much gas.
And
the person that has a truck or vehicle that eats a lot of gas is paying the cost when they're gassing up and getting that gallon of gas. So to me, it would seem... Totally, because you got bridges that need to be repaired. They used to give towns and cities some monies for fixing bridges.
Well, they used to do, but it takes you 10 years to get to that.
It's a
10-year plan.
But, and we're almost there.
Yeah, we are. But
anyhow, you know, they used to do that, and you don't. You get very little now.
Margaret, I see your hand over there.
Yeah, I just, somewhere
Mark,
I read...
You know, just announced
Margaret Watkins. Somewhere I read, I believe it was the gas tax, that a lot of that is being diverted to other purposes than roads and the original intent of the money. And you're saying no, it's not.
It's going to the Biden and I-93. Two things. It's controversial because some of that money tends to go pay for the state police. They put the state police budget out of there now.
Yeah.
So people are complaining that it's not going to the roads, but they've been doing that for years and years. This is not a new thing. The second one is when we put the last gas tax increase in, the 4 cents, what was that, 4 or 5 years ago?
4.2, actually.
Yeah.
Was it 4.2?
You would know.
The money is also going to widen 993.
Okay, so there isn't a big diversion of the money going into other stuff. Other than
what?
Big is relative. Mary Beth and I may have differences of opinion on this, right? We currently peel off about 31% total of all of the money raised from gas taxes and diverted to other things. Some of that is state police, some of that is the court system, some of that is 93. So I look at 31% as a big percentage. Just we tried to get it back down into the mid-20s, and that's a real number when you're talking a pool of money in the hundreds of millions of dollars.
Yeah. Mike just pointed out to me that on the block grant funding, it's Minnesota received 12% of the gas tax revenue, and with the increase, there's an additional $4 million that's returned to any of the cities and towns. So we have gotten a little bit more from the increase in the, you know, the gas tax, and it is paving more roads now, and you know, working. My forte is fuel distribution, but I do have an ear to what's going on the roads, and it's a lot easier to take and keep good roads good.
Yes.
Less money than it is to take them hard. let them go to hell and then try to rebuild them. It's also a lot easier on the commuters too, because you're not on them as long with construction, so.
Not on such bad roads, causing more damage to your car.
Yes, that too. Oh, it's a cascade effect, I mean, you know, along the way, so. But yeah, we have definitely found that it's a lot easier to keep good roads good. And that's what we're trying to do with, you know, with Grapevine Road, for example, it's the way to get it to be good and keep it good, and the ones we're doing, so.
So does some of that tax money come back to the towns?
Yes, it did. We had an increase in the block grant, but I.
$9,000, I think we had budgeted $90,000, and we got $99,000.
It's based on the mile, in miles in the, you know, linear miles in the roadway we have in the town. I think they're like 40 miles or something like that. Part of the block grant.
Yeah.
Because we have Mansion Road, 13, 77, Stark Lane, I believe.
So it's based on state roads.
Those are state roads, so, but Stark Lane and Mansion Road are paved.
Everdam
is also because of Clough. So we have a sizable amount of state roads in the town too, non-numbered highway, you know, state roads, so. Those don't count towards a block grant that we get.
And also, I'm with Bob on increasing the tax on gas. If we need more money in that fund, I think that that's pushing us in the right direction in the big scheme of things.
Folks, anybody else have thoughts, concerns, questions? Nothing on here? Oh. Janet, you
know, I'd like to ask our three representatives, do you think we have voter fraud in New Hampshire?
No. In a word, no.
Do you?
In Dunbarton? No. In New Hampshire, yes. I can share with you videos that I've seen. Dunbarton's not a problem. Town clerk knows everybody. I mean, it's a very different place. It's not like we're drilling in the center of Manchester, where it's really easy to actually claim that you're working at a campaign office as your home address, that's not a residential place, to vote. And things like that have been proven. So it, how big is the percentage? That we can discuss, but there has been some.
I'm with JR on that.
But,
what about our election laws? I think that there are big problems with the election laws.
So we saw 4,000 postcards that were mailed out after, these are people who signed affidavits during the election.
I apologize for the wrong.
That's okay. After the 2012 election, there was a number of postcards mailed out to people who signed affidavits at the polling places, either because they didn't have ID or they were a new resident, any of the affidavits. And of those, they mailed out more than 4,000. I believe 4,000 were returned, okay, as address undeliverable type things. These people did not live at the address they claimed. That is an issue. None of those were followed up. So we should also, before we make changes, we should also look to see that the laws we have in place, what do we have to do to enforce the laws we have in place? Okay, and to, right? So if they're trying to make fixes to the laws so they're easier to enforce because they found problems, that's one thing. It's different to change to set a new standard.
Nobody recognized that address undeliverable could be because many of these people had moved. And there were variety, and also people who got them, they weren't all address undeliverable, they were the ones that were not returned. Many people simply as a matter of principle refused to return them because they were so outraged by the whole system. So there were a variety of reasons those cards didn't come back, and it's popular to make the argument that that's indication of voter fraud. Personally, I don't buy it.
Especially if you want to tighten up the voting.
Supervisors of the checklist and
the voting rules.
If we have reason to believe someone's not where they say they are. And many of those don't come back either. And then they'll show up at an election and say, yes, I was here. You know, they just didn't do the letter. Or a parent tossed it or something.
Right. So, and all of those are part of it. The question is what do, it's not, in my eyes, it's not a black and white issue, it's a matter of gray, right? It's not zero, and it's not 100%. The question is it 1%, 0.1%, I don't know. We can talk about what level, but I can guarantee we don't have a perfect system in terms of no voter fraud, but the question is it a real issue, or is it an insignificant issue, and that, I don't know.
I might add that the whole question about whether campaign workers are residents, I worked on the Hillary Clinton campaign, and I knew campaign workers that came from out of state and lived here for 18 months.
Did they vote in the New Hampshire primary? You bet they did. But they had lived here for 18 months, had apartments, were full-born residents. Some of them left after the election, some didn't. But they lived here, and from my point of view, if you lived here 18 months, you got every right to vote.
I was going to weigh in on it.
And why don't we consider the license IDs, the license, auto license, as the mechanism for IDs for voting?
I'm not sure I understand.
Makes it simple?
So we do, right? So if I may, right? Currently, you have to show an ID to vote, or you have to sign an affidavit. The ID that is acceptable is a state-issued ID, which is typically a driver's license, although there may be some people who have military IDs who could use those. But predominantly, people show their driver's license as an ID.
The problem is when people get older and they stop driving and they give up their license, then they don't always have the ID. Some of our older residents also don't have birth certificates. They don't have some of the traditional things that makes it harder for them to get an ID that's being recognized. It's less of a problem in New Hampshire than some other states, but it's still a problem that when you give up your driver's license and you have to show a photo ID to vote, some people just don't have them anymore.
Could we make it a lot easier? Just throwing this out, I mean, when you give up your license to drive, because I had a grandfather that did that back in the 70s, can't we give them a non-driver's ID?
Yes.
Just swap it one for one?
But the problem is by the time they're giving up their license to drive, you have to get a non-driver's ID, you have to go up to DMV. And those people often don't have a means to get up to DMV. They're at a point where they're not driving, and it's often there.
I guess what I'm just saying, you know, you send it in the mail, and you'll pick up a form, and they just send them back, because they use the same picture, and send them back. It's the same information, just you can't drive with it.
Yeah.
Find a simple way for it. I'm just, Don?
Don Larson. Are you guys going to do away with the same-day registration? And make it 30 days.
I don't like that idea.
They have no way of checking it.
So, I believe there is an effort, there's at least one bill in, to move not to 30 days. I don't know who picked the number, it was 13, of all things. It wasn't 2 weeks, it wasn't 10 days, right? But anyway, it was 13 days. I don't know why. I don't know where that bill is, but there was an effort that...
It's less than 2 weeks.
Yeah, it's less than 2 weeks. My issue is 30 days is a long window. I mean, you've got effectively 10%, right? 8 to 10% of the people who move here in any given year, and summer tends to be a higher moving season than winter, so it may even be higher than 10%, right? That would be disenfranchised at some level. One same day creates the other thing is how do you know that they were actually residents here? So there's probably a fair balance between the two. 2 weeks seems like a good window. 1 week, anything, even the day before, right? I mean, that would put more work on Linda, but if they had to show up the day before and register to vote.
The problem, the complication, the kind of the elephant in the room nobody's talking about is motor voter. We have same-day registration because it exempted us from motor voter, and it was one of those things that I think it was Gene Shaheen got through so that we didn't have, because we don't have central car or license registration like many states do. They have it all centralized. You can walk into your town clerk, as you know, and deal with a lot of these car issues. And so that was why we went to same-day registration. What's not clear to me in this legislature, if they think if they're getting rid of same-day registration, how are they going to deal with the federal motor voter requirement? So I think it's more complicated than many people are yet recognizing. But it is a complicated issue.
I apologize. I'm kind of hard of hearing, Mary. I didn't quite hear that.
I said, okay, so there's a federal motor voter law that came in that said that when you register your car, you're automatically, you get to register to vote.
Oh, okay.
Because we have a different system here of the way we register things, it's more decentralized. Gene Shaheen got a thing through, I think it was Gene, I could be wrong, but I think it was Gene, he got a thing through that said instead of having to do motor voter, we're going to allow same-day registration. So if we get rid of same-day registration, that throws us back in the pool where we have to do motor voter. And whoever's dealing with that in the legislature has to recognize that and figure out what they're going to do with it.
Gotcha. I apologize. I'm kind of hard of hearing, so when you have I apologize if it's wrong. Yeah. It is horrible, this kind of get together, and but unfortunately, it's all we have to work with right now, so appreciate your patience with that. Anybody else? Okay. Go Leo. You already have, just because he hasn't spoken yet.
Okay, what about voter fraud with absentee ballots? Because nobody knows who's voting on that ballot. Correct?
Right, they're signing an affidavit, either, you know...
Well, they're signing an affidavit, but are they in front of a notary when they're voting, or...
No.
Exactly, so a lot of those are going out of state. Anybody's voting, sending them back in, right?
I don't think that's a new problem. I voted absentee 30 years ago a lot when I was moving around, and...
Well, I'm not saying everybody's...
Right.
You know, I'm not saying everybody's doing it illegally or mismanaging it or misusing it, rather. But I'm saying that could be voter fraud. That could be a big place for voter fraud, is the absentee ballot.
One way to address it, and certainly the way I addressed it when I was voting, and that is you have to have your signature on the application for the absentee ballot. And you have to go through a whole process before you can get the absentee ballot. I'm sure the clerk could tell us more than I can about this. And then when the ballot comes back, the signatures have to match it.
The moderator is required to check the signature on the affidavit that the absentee voter signs, as well as to compare that against the signature on the application for the absentee ballot.
But you're right, Leo, you don't know who's filling it up once it comes out.
I know of cases where the elderly people were told where to check the mark.
Mm-hmm, I'm sure it happens.
I believe it.
Hold on.
If I may, right, the selectman, the moderator, the town clerk are the ones. There is some level of process. It uses signatures, right? Mm-hmm. It's comparing handwriting to handwriting. Having sat there one day volunteering, it's not the easiest job in the world because no one signs the paper identically. And yeah, those chicken scratches look very much like those chicken scratches, or they don't. And I've seen ballots that have been contested and then they just don't go in. So there is some level. Is it good enough? No.
You go into a booth and nobody's telling you how to vote. Then you're sitting here and somebody's telling you put that check right there. And you still scratch your chicken scratchings on the bottom. That's your that's your signature, but somebody told you where to check, what box to check. Yeah.
But Leo, to solve that, I think you'd have to disenfranchise every other vote.
Well, what I'm saying is I'm bringing up a point that no matter what you do, you're going to get something.
The system's not perfect.
Exactly.
Well, to get an absentee ballot, don't you have to be a registered voter to start out with?
Yes.
So, I mean, you've got, you know, so that eliminates a lot of fraud right there. I mean, I voted absentee in the primary because we were out of town. And that, but, you know, I couldn't get it unless I was already registered to vote. No, I'm listening. I know some situations that occur that...
Deb had her hand up first while I'm talking.
I have a question on House Bill 394. It's something to do about state employees testifying.
Yes.
And there's been a proposed change, and I'm not sure why.
So 394 was my bill. I put it in.
Right.
Okay. And it didn't say you couldn't testify.
No, but it says you have to get permission from your senior.
It either is left, right? So what we're seeing is Dunbarton doesn't do this. This is not an issue, but I've seen other towns where we have particular town employees who are at the state house large portions of time, okay? I'm going to use a chief of police as a good example, where the chief is there 3 days a week. Well, that would be fine, except if you have a town the size of ours, right? We can't afford to have a chief at the state house 3 days a week. So there's been issues with that, and some would even say would use the word abuse of their ability to go down and testify on a bill. So this would just say that they need the selectmen to say, yes, we want you to go down, or the chairman has invited them, or they're there on their own, right? All of those were options.
But it said public service, so how public far
employees.
Reaching is that?
Public employees. So
how far reaching is public? Because public can go all the way to the federal level.
Public employees are defined in the chapter that defines public employees in our state. So there's an entire list of people who are considered public employees. Under 270 something.
Federal.
No.
The public. So it's a real problem?
We have seen a number of times where criminal justice is where you see this issue the most. Okay.
But isn't there a reason why the police chief might have to be there three times a week?
Well, maybe, but that's fine as long as the selectman, right, his boss in this case would be the board of selectmen or town manager.
But that also applies to school superintendents?
No, superintendents are elected. Oh, sorry, superintendent, I'm thinking board of ed. I'm sorry, local school board. Right, superintendent, yes. The school board members, no.
So, I was unaware of JR's bill, but I want to say why those people are there. Those people are there because you have things like the Association of Police Chiefs, you have the, something similar for the fire, you have the Association of Superintendents and the Association of School Boards, and they bring in, or and even the Municipal Association will bring in one or two town managers. Okay, so they bring them in, people that are more articulate, that understand the issues, that are more experienced.
Subject matter experts.
Right. Well, or just generally experts, or they want to represent that association, so they're in there. So JR is right, you're going to see the same police chief in there through, you know, basically January, February, March, when we're hearing those bills, and a little bit less so when stuff comes into the Senate, you're going to see the same people. Personally, I don't have a problem with that. If the town's unhappy with that person being absent, I'm sure they're aware they're absent, and they're going to deal with it on their own. But that's why you have so many public employees in there. But I'm also concerned because that would apply to state employees, it sounds like, and it would apply...
So there was an entire discussion, right? There was carve-outs for all of the typical cases where we see people there. For instance, right, someone asks, a supervisor asks, I'm in DES, I asked my employee to be there to testify on this bill because it affects, I don't know, water culverts or whatever. So all of those carve-outs that are typical were in the bill to allow them to be there. Including the chairman says, hey, I need someone from DES to come and testify, or I need someone from the Municipal Association while they're on a state. I need someone from the Department of Safety to be there.
Jeff?
Just a comment.
Yeah.
JR, this really sounds like it's a issue between an employee and an employer, and the state really shouldn't be getting involved in it. I mean, it really... It sounds like the state government's trying to manage employee and employer relationships, and I don't think you should be going
there.
Well, but
I agree.
For those who are state employees, right, who are members of the SEIU, there may be, right, we also don't want, as taxpayers, to have departments going in and asking for more functions that drive up taxes. So there's the other side of this, right? And that's why it had particular carve-outs to make sure that all of the supported functions that needed to be met could be met.
Yeah, I'm thinking more in terms of municipal
right.
folks who may show up. If the police chief is there a lot, yep. that's between the selectman or the town council and the police
right.
chief.
Right.
I don't think the state should be getting involved, you know, into that
okay.
relationship.
No.
Well, I can speak to the state side of that is because as serving as the director of the SEA, not the SEIU, because that's a national, we always ask employees if they're going to go testify to make sure they're on their own time. So they take annual time or comp time or whatever they have on the books. So they're not there as a paid employee, you know, taken away from their duties.
And some departments are extraordinarily good, and other departments not so.
A lot of, it may depend on what the bill is in regard to their, you know, funding sources and stuff like that, because they will rally them on that. But again, that's usually up to the commissioner level that will decide that.
Well, I
okay, just, guys. I saw two hands at once. Well, yeah. You want to flip a coin? Or ladies first?
No, I just
want to
say I think that's overreaching by the state into the local municipalities. And if you're okay with doing it for the state employees because maybe you're a state run, but don't reach into the towns.
Okay.
I think that's out of line, not necessary.
Well,
I'd like to change the subject slightly.
Go ahead.
On the solar proliferation of solar bills that were addressing the solar cap,
yes.
What's happening with those?
Okay.
Net metering.
We have one.
Oh, I got a whole list of bills here.
Yes, eight of them, right?
Well, yeah, give me some numbers. Which ones do you want to talk about? I can tell you where they are.
Just a general, what did the technology committee
okay,
do on those?
All right, the net metering bill, I think we retained, and only reason it's up in a docket at the PUC. They're going to come out with a number. And what you're talking about is how much are you going to get back for your solar power, either wholesale or retail price. We are not going into that because there is a docket at the PUC and they'll come up with a number on that. There's also discussion going on about RPS.
Yeah, RPS and the caps.
And the caps. Let me see where we are on that one. That's still in committee. That is my committee right now.
What is RPS?
renewable portfolios standard. Got it.
Got some people.
Yeah, I know.
So what is the committee's thinking on that?
At the moment, I don't know. To be honest with you, I don't know at the moment. I'm looking at the bills here. If you could give me a bill number, it would help a heck of a lot.
The bills all have to be on the street.
593 was one of them, I think.
Almost two.
Yeah. 518?
518? Yeah, eliminating, that's, I told you, we retained that one right here.
Yeah, okay.
So that means that's the one the PUC is gonna be working on. It should come up with something by June, I was told, June 30th. There was a lot of discussion about that.
You're out of session then, hopefully.
On the June we finish.
Yeah, well, it is budget year, right?
Exactly. That's why I said hopefully.
Okay, there was one up there for repealing a Reggie, the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative. We retained that bill also in committee, so nothing's going forward on that. Nobody's repealing Reggie.
Okay, so but that means it comes back up
next year after January 1st. Right. Net metering, cap on net metering. Anything else? I mean, I got dozens of.
I have a list of them, but I didn't bring it.
Give me a call, and we'll go over them one by one. I'd be very happy to do that. Okay.
If we're doing utility bills, stop. By back to you. I spent the day fighting for a bill today. I just wanted to get him to retain it and not kill it. And we may. It's going to be voted on in Ways and Means next Tuesday. It's a bill that's come up. I've had it in at least three times. I think it's been up at least five or six, maybe as many as eight and ten, because I've lost track of it. In 1980, this state passed a tax exemption for pollution control devices. Okay? It was an incentive in 1980, just as the environmental movement was getting started, trying to get people to put clean up things to clean up the air and the water. At that point, when it was passed, it had a 25-year life. For reasons unbeknownst to me, former Bow State Representative Mike Wally, the late Mike Wally, got the bill through that removed the 25-year cap. It is now in perpetuity. So we have things that were built in the 60s, the 70s, and the 80s, for example, at the Merrimack Station, that we can't touch. That $500 million stack that they put up on the coal plant down there, we can't touch it. We can never tax that under current law. So I have been working on this bill again, and I'm just fighting like crazy to convince people to hang on to it so we can try and work on a solution, because if they kill it, it's coming back next term, I'll guarantee it. This time it was brought in by the reps from Hampton, because the pipes from Seabrook are covered by it, and it's like $1.5 million to Hampton. It's worth it to them. I can't even figure out what it would cost Bo, or how much it would give Bo if we can do this. I don't know if you have pollution control devices somewhere in town. But if you do, you can't tax them, and you probably don't even know it because they're totally exempt. So at any rate, I just wanted to let you know that we're fighting to do that as well and try and make it so that we may not get to tax that stack for another 20 years. But the point is, no tax exemption should be in perpetuity. There should be a point at which it sunsets. Tax exemptions are put in to motivate people to do the right thing. It's now required by federal law. You don't need it to motivate people to put pollution control devices on. They're already doing it. So let's allow people at some point to start taxing them. So that was my big fight today and Tuesday. Pardon?
I've read about that one. Jeff?
Just one last thing. I'm on the New Hampshire Building Code Review Board, and there's a bill coming up to update our building code, New Hampshire State Building Code, and I'd like to urge all three of you to please approve that. We are currently under the 2009 versions of the I-codes. This will bring us up to the 2015 versions. Under the 2009 versions, I'm a structural engineer. The design standard that I use is 2005. It's 12 years old. We go up to 2015 version of the I-codes, I'll at least get up to the 2010 version of that same standard I use. We really need to modernize our building codes. There's been a lot of changes that have happened in the industry over the last dozen years, and we've got to get our building code back up again.
Hey, you're good.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, that's probably the contentious one for the next week. All the easy ones.
Anybody else?
Going
once? Twice? Sold. All right, guys. We're going to wrap it up here, and I'm sure you guys want to get home as well. And so.
Just want to say thank you on behalf of the selectmen. I appreciate you coming out.
Thank you.
And we would like to invite you back in the future, too.
On some regular basis, again, thank you very much. We, you know, try not to make this adversarial. We just hope to have conversations. Yeah. So get the feel, I think. A good, basically, feel for how we are, you know, looking at things that are in your committees and the legislature in general, far as the downside of things. Basically, I think we said it earlier, a lot of cost shifting has gone on over time, and we're feeling the crunch. And if you guys can do anything to help us out, as the town, you know, revenue sharing that's been promised in the past, that's been taken away, stuff of that nature, we'd really appreciate it, because as taxpayers, it's, you know, it's showing up.
And we're taxpayers, too. So
absolutely. Absolutely.
And I live in Bow. We know what's happening in there.
Yep, I do. I got a son that lives on Bow Bog recently, and I'm sure he's going to feel it, too.
Okay.
Thanks.
Jeff, is yours the PE license?
Thank you for your service.
Well, I'm not running yet. Oh, I just wanted to talk about it.
Yes, that's me.
RPS.
Thank you.
All right.
I wish I had the bill.
I mean, they don't do that now, but I got to tell you,
hey, Bob.
Can you be the sergeant at arms? Oh, no, no, can you be the sergeant at arms and kind of marshal them out, please?
Oh, okay, yeah.
We'll leave.
No, that's all right.
Okay, we're on our way out, guys.
Guys, can we get you to head out?
We're gonna leave in a second.
There's a teacher at Goss Town Hall there, but.
Okay, I'm out of here.
Okay, bye-bye, so Tuesday.
Everybody can stay if they want to, they just.
Oh, where is?
I'll tell you what about.
So you know this stuff, you're a good resource.
Everybody's coming.
Leo's here, Leo's here.
We're all sitting there. No, we get done too.
I told him I was staying.
All right.
Return from recess?
Yeah, return from recess.
There we go. You misunderstood my question totally.
8:27. We're probably in recess before 8:25, so you can lose track. All righty, next on the agenda is this pile of paperwork right here. This is the warrant.
Not just help them do it.
Yep.
But there's the thing, I mean, it's like, hey, Alex, this is somebody who can do this.
I got my training on warrants.
There's the thing, that's the system, there's somebody else.
Webinar.
Oh, did you?
Yes.
Which question?
They had a webinar about preparing warrants and using the software tool.
Yeah.
So I know the misery that she goes through now.
Yes.
And so it was worthwhile. I was only five people online, but they face yourself and they open up for questions, and it's a neat tool.
Yeah, I think we did like a PowerPoint last year.
PowerPoint.
I had a big class, there's nine.
Oh, my gosh, okay.
There's not a whole lot of people.
No.
No, because it's the administrative duties, but what it does do is it includes all the different pieces. So I've got given permission rights to the tax collector, so she can upload her documents, permission rights for the town clerk, and now just this, today, I got two emails asking for permission, sending permission rights to the auditor. So everyone that has a Department of Revenue form, official form that needs to be completed by its different department, has to have access to that.
Section.
That portal to upload their own personal, so that's not going through a third person and changing things or whatever. So it's a good checks and balances, it's.
All righty, so it's basically signing the warrants. We've already voted on all this, so we don't have to re-vote or anything, we just have to sign.
Correct, yep.
We gotta sign every single one of these, right?
Correct.
Well then, I'm gonna pass them out. One for you. One for you. Another one for you. Another one for you.
They're all the same?
Yeah.
Yep.
Basically.
So there's three spots to sign.
I got.
Two on the back page and one on the second to last. Or vice versa.
Do you have a pencil?
Yes. Yes, we do. But if you use it, we're gonna have to slap with a ruler again.
So I will be posting these on the website, Hot Topics. And while you're signing that, you want me to just go over my things to talk to the board about? Received a call from Senator McGilvray, I can't pronounce that name.
McGilvray.
McGilvray. He said he wasn't able to make it today, so he said he'd be glad to meet with board next Thursday. So do you want me to go ahead and invite him for discussion, or?
I think it'd be worthwhile.
Okay.
And just, if we can, just the people that were here today and.
Let them know.
Let them know again if they wanna come back, just for that one person.
Okay. Just the board should be aware that I've been in touch with Score Construction and Cohen Steel. We've scheduled a meeting for.
I saw the.
Next Wednesday at 1:00, and this is to possibly come up with an alternative design to the steel that was recommended by Joel Fisher. So I'll go that route first. If there's something that they can come up with, then I'll pass it on to Joel Fisher to either approve or.
Those two.
That one's.
Who should be in attendance for that meeting?
I think it's working, Cohen Steel said that they'd be willing to work with Score Construction to either modify the steel that was made for the work that needs to be done, or come up with another alternative to.
Are either of you gentlemen available then?
I will, I plan.
I can join the club.
Good, okay.
Well, I'm just posted as a meeting, you'll have a quorum.
Yep.
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 If you truly need me, then let me know, but I think, to be honest with you, I'm very comfortable with just having a quorum or two.
But we're not deciding anything there, we're more.
No, but you're still talking town business, so you just post it as a meeting and just cover CYA.
Yep, good.
Minutes will be real simple, just went over this and that and done.
Also, got word that the town reports will be delivered to the town offices tomorrow. I still have to, I just completed our postal permit and I have to process that check, so those will be delivered to the post office till next Wednesday, Thursday. So I'll be asking the board to do the dedication of the annual report before next Thursday evening.
Before next Thursday?
Well, I don't want to do it before the meeting or on Thursday. And then I can request the delivery starts no earlier than next Friday.
They're gonna get them out there in time, like by our.
Yeah, we actually had a schedule, we got them done real quick. PDF ready comes in handy when they don't have to change things or modify things.
Beautiful.
So.
I think there's more than one there, isn't there? I thought there was like five copies.
Do you want me to try to invite the individual to a meeting or do we want to go to their resident to dedicate that report?
The report time with dedication.
I'm good either way, I mean, is there a way to?
To get them here?
Yeah, get them here. Know about a way to get them here?
Who's that?
Personally dedicating.
I can try giving them a buzz, asking them if they can come by prior to the meeting.
For next Thursday, next week?
Or for 7 o'clock, if we can get them here, then we'll get them here for 7 o'clock.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So we can expect to do that.
What's that?
We have a question for the lady to answer.
Right.
Right. Require a circle.
I'm not gonna tell them what it's about anyway.
All right.
Or you can lie.
Whenever you get caught with something, that's the first thing you do is lie.
I'm just gonna double check, make sure.
We only signed this on the front, right?
Just the front, yep, and you were all given a copy of that last week.
All right, so two for you, one for me, I'll look that up. Yeah, I'll look at that one. Here's. MS-636. That one was the warrant.
That's one, I don't have to sign anywhere else.
Nope, just.
They gave me a second one.
Whether or not I think these get scanned and uploaded to the Department of Revenue, right?
They do.
Yes, they do, exactly.
But they do want, request an original, so I have to mail one out to them.
They were talking about that yesterday.
That's why one is paperclip.
Four copies?
Five copies. Yeah, they all get nice. Beautiful. Good, that's done.
All right.
Mailbox. All right, you have an application for leave from Lean. I assume we're all good with this, consensus?
Yep.
327 to 331?
Yep.
That's all?
It's a week.
For now.
That's less than a week.
No, 5 days.
Yeah.
So,
well,
eight, nine,
I don't work weekends.
30, 31.
I try not to work weekends.
Okay. 5:40.
What's the date set?
27th of March.
Yeah, 27th to.
The 31st.
31st.
Right, next on the file, we have a, that was attached to, caught on the back of the Hillboro grant, I caught that. This is the elementary school, FYF school one. So basically boils down to what, $3 over last year's budget for the school?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Ouch.
And their town meeting is March 11th?
March 11th.
At 3 o'clock.
That's assuming that everything gets passed.
Everything gets passed, yes. If everything gets passed, the corner, you know, on the school budget and their warrants, it's going to be a $3 increase over their 2016 rate. again, I hope that people realize that their budget is three times our budget and that they ought to go there. So, and not, they should go to both meetings, but I mean, don't ignore the school. All right, we got a note from Dave Montgomery that came this afternoon regarding that. They looked to, looks like they're going to try to expedite the process of installing fiber to the Armin's Way.
Yeah, I talked to him after this email came out. Mm-hmm. He said there is a switch with fiber optic access already out there. Mm-hmm. They're going to try to utilize what they have to get a little more internet access out there faster.
And, yeah, that's nice. It'll be reactive.
Yeah, good. And I thanked him for being engaged already.
I didn't have time this afternoon to write back, so we can do that.
I gave him a call, and he was, I thought, I gave him some kudos for stepping up to the plate.
Oh, Dave's a good guy. I went to school with Dave, and he's a real stand-up guy. He'll do his best for him.
But the thing is, I think we should just revisit it after the election. I think,
absolutely.
In fairness to the people who came from Waterney Way, we need to keep it on the radar scope.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, we can start doing that work now, and you know, we may not get a date till after you know, town meeting and such, but I mean, we start working on it.
Yes, and the thing is, what we want to do is get some stakeholders to the table.
Comcast, us, telephone, GSI probably ought to be there too, you know, because they're the ones supplying the DSL.
Yeah,
we asked JR to get us a name for a resident on that neck of the woods.
And things, this can also, this can be like a case. I mean, any other places in town where Comcast comes and then stops, but it's just like in the same street, we could set a precedent of how they would want to handle this in the future.
Oh,
because it's not exclusively just the state away.
Yep.
Okay, but I think we just keep on the radar scope.
Right, no, we start, do we have any contacts with Comcast? Because I think they're going to, I mean, they're about
to. I had some old ones, but they, I guess their problem was resolved because they installed the fiber optics down in Stinson Hills. There was that woman that came before the board maybe 3 or 4 years ago, and she had connections.
Well, I thought the folks at Armin's Way were talking to someone that was pretty high up in Comcast. It was
on the
emails.
Yeah, maybe in the emails.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, those four can...
they met on a plane or something.
Yep, exactly.
Okay.
Is it possible to maybe ask you to be so kind? Maybe just throw an email, see if they're still interested in, or point us in the right direction who to talk to.
Okay.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, that would be Jim Bavona, or he was the one that was instrumental in.
Right, but I mean, the Comcast person.
Right.
Email them.
Right, okay.
Mm-hmm. So, that would be good. And we can start, you know, find a time when they can get here, we can get here, whether it's a Thursday night or not. I mean, we, you know, have a round table and try to.
I don't think it's
good. Get the conversation started.
Sorry, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're not going to solve it overnight.
No. But the thing is, as I said, there may be, let's say this neighborhood is taken care of via the Dunbar Telephone Company, but there may be other neighborhoods which may be applicable. I think you were alluding to the, you're very close to the border.
Well, when they put Comcast in Bow and brought it up Wood Hill, they literally, for, I want to say, about 6 months, kept putting tags on my doorknob, you know, saying, hey, Comcast is a neighborhood. My wife would call and say, oh, great. You know, we get rid of the dial-up because it was back when they had dial-up. And, nope, you're in Dunbarton, sorry. I mean, the pole is literally inches from my property line.
It just doesn't make sense now.
No.
But so that would, I think we got a plan.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
Check that.
Yeah, if we can get that ball rolling, that'd be nice. I like, you know, don't want to take him, let it die. Speaking of, I know I'm kind of going out of order here, but it just popped in my head. The Guinea Road stuff, has Fred ever gotten back to you as in...
No, actually, the individual that had petitioned or approached the selectman said we're going
to
back off for now.
Oh,
and
that's
we will,
nice to
me. Well, he brought his information to his neighborhood meeting, and he said if we're still interested in pursuing it, we'll get reach back, you know, we'll
okay,
get
so,
back in touch
so
with the
town. So we can take that off the table then?
Yeah, I think so.
That was
so.
A renaming of
the renaming of it, They wanted to name it in honor of Jim. I understand that, but we already have a stone road, and then they want to name that one, so it would really affect a couple different roads.
Yeah, because I picked up the phone and called, and he said that based on the information that he had learned, he was bringing that back to his neighborhood to discuss it, and if they decide to pursue it again, that he would reach out to us, and I haven't heard from him.
You want to ask a favor? Would you throw the together like a quick memo and attach it to the petition and throw it in the Guinea Road folder so it doesn't get... It stays there for.
I thought I put it.
No, it's still in the box.
But I think I put a note on it saying that this has been tabled. Okay, I'll double check it.
I apologize, I didn't read that.
Yeah, I can do that.
I know, it's been in there for a while.
It has. That's why it just dawned on me when you said, you know.
Okay.
We have a letter from John Wigan. He is tending his resignation as the acting building inspector effective the 31st of March. The health officer.
I think Lean's got some good news on that.
We have had a couple of inquiries. We have, I have one application, and then I've spoken personally to the inspector of Bo, so I'm hoping he'll follow up and fill out, because I sent him the application for employment, so.
Yeah, still have to do interviews and stuff like that, you know, get everybody fair shake.
Yep.
According to his letter, though, you would like to continue as the assistant, the assistant building inspector. But we can take that up when the time comes. Currently right now he's the acting building inspector, but it's because he's in the position of the assistant building inspector, so.
Yeah.
Was there such a position as assistant building inspector?
Yeah, we had two.
Yeah.
We had the building inspector and the assistant.
But on the assistant level, it was to cover vacations, to fill in, to do, business inspections for.
That's not a yearly appointed position, is it?
No.
So basically, once he does this, he just automatically falls back into it.
Right.
Unless you gentlemen see any reason why not,
So he's almost like a PRN on call.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Building inspector.
Yeah.
Right, but I mean, when he, as of the 31st, so April 1st, he basically reverts back to his original role as assistant building inspector.
Right.
Personally, I'm good with that. He's done a great job for us in the interim. The health officer, though, we got to find somebody that's interested in that. Where a feel is out for that, I guess. And so I guess I'll make a motion to accept John Williams' resignation as the acting building inspector and health officer with sincere regret and complete gratitude and appreciation for his job well done in those capacities.
I'll second the motion.
So, any discussion? Except we're not going to accept it.
No, you got to stay in the position. I don't think we have a choice.
Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Health officer, I'm gonna familiarize myself with that position. What are your responsibilities?
Not much at all.
No.
You're really the focal point for receiving letters from, the state level, if there's any type of emergency.
If we get a call saying, my neighbor's house is a sty, they're a hoarder, it's unfit.
Is it a paid position?
Well,
thanks for helping.
No problem.
I think it was pretty much included with the building inspector's position. So if they were here, they worked out, health related inspections.
They do have responsibilities, but it's more towards on the health side, you have 50 animals living in the house, and you condemn the houses like that. That's what.
I think it's a requirement of the state that we have a designee for that title.
Yeah.
So that they can get newsletters and.
Well, I think I've got a health background on it. Maybe the job is the description for it, and I'll get back to the board.
All right.
Okay, you got one.
Say again?
I said, okay, you got one.
Yeah. I'll take a look and get to us in the mouth, right?
Yeah, you're it.
All in favor?
You know what they said in the military?
Yeah. Yeah, you ought to know better than that, my friend. You ought to know better than that. I learned that long ago. One step back.
That's why it's called read the job description first.
Yeah. I don't think there's one that exists, but there are.
Must be some
RSAs.
Yeah. Okay. I get some homework.
This is what the town report's going to look like.
Okay. But there is a border. This one is the proof, and they omitted the border, so there is a border that will be.
Oh, so we can just get our marker out and draw that.
Something like that.
We'll drop the coffee on it.
It's got about, 143 pages?
Mm-hmm.
So. It's getting thicker, folks. It's getting thicker.
But it actually weighs less this year. I think it's the coil.
Good.
Last year was 132 or 134. This one's about 10 pages more. Last year's was about 13.4 ounces.
I don't know.
This is 12.9, so I think it has to do with the coil.
All right, let's get moving here. We got an email from Donna Dunn regarding the Historical Awareness Committee. There we go. It was in front of me, I just couldn't think of it.
Historical Awareness
Committee. Dunbarton Historical Awareness Committee. Donna Dunn sent us an email, just kind of as an FYI regarding the Black History Month in Dunbarton, what they call a teacher tidbit sheet. That's pretty nice. I think they did a great job with it.
Yeah.
Be honest with you.
Yep.
It's good to know. And I know you're on the committee. Well, mm-hmm. Thank you. You guys did a good job with that.
Yeah,
appreciate that.
I had her do it.
Pardon?
I had her do it.
Well, I mean, that's good stuff. I mean, the kids can learn stuff like that.
Yeah, right.
Even some of us old folks can learn stuff with that.
We kind of take every month as it. You know, like this is Black History Month, and yes. we research and see what we can find that has to do with Dunbarton and try to, because it's supposed to be teaching kids, you know.
Yep, yep.
So,
yeah, I know.
So,
she did a good job.
Yeah.
Well, kudos to her and the committee. Greatly appreciate that. It's good.
Yeah, you are.
All right, and I think Wes is just legislative bulletins we already have.
Yep.
Yeah, over, so.
Those are just for information we need.
Yep. Oh, no, that's throw it on the table then. You got anything else?
No. Nope.
What?
This is a pen.
That's for you. Inside joke, folks.
There you go.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, that's okay.
Okay.
I got one.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, I think it's for the record. The thing is, I was catching a fellow selectman. I won't say the names, but he was using a pencil to initial tonight. And we require a pen. You didn't know that, you know, there was a little trouble with that pencil.
Probably didn't realize that selectman was going to erase the signature after you were done.
Magic marker.
Yeah. We've got to have a little humor here, so I bring that up.
I'm just glad I didn't use crayon.
But I'm good, thank you.
All right, my thing was the Guinea Road, right off the top of my head. Other than that, I'd like to say thank you to Lee for her unyielding support of our budget season sessions and such, and really appreciate it. I want to say thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's a lot of behind-the-scenes work that goes in putting all this together, and we get it all signed tonight, and everything's put to bed, and everything looks great. And again, thank you very much for your sincere. Really appreciate all that work you put in there.
Thank you. I think it's getting a little bit easier as the years go on. We've got a good system going and all the tools we need. Just need to find some time that's not too disruptive and get it done.
Excellent. Look forward to getting my own copy and reading it.
Yep. You didn't remember what you voted on.
That could be true. That's why I had minutes.
I have one thing. In the Town Hall Restoration Committee has developed a questionnaire that they're putting online for people to access. They've got a few different places that they want to have it. But they're also wondering if it's possible for the town to copy 200 copies. It would be double-sided with the questionnaire, so they could have it at one where the town meeting is, and have some here at Linda's office and the administrator's office.
Yeah.
So that when people come in, if they want to take one, it's only a few minutes time, and they can get it done. So if it's possible, I mean, I've got a copy of what it looks like, but I don't know if that's the final version, and I can have Margaret Watkins give you a call?
Yeah, we have all the committees that get involved, Energy Committee and others that do the same thing.
Yep.
They'll bring, you know, just email and a PDF, and then
they don't have any money for their budget, do they?
No.
No. I mean, it would just absorb it in the.
They're trying to raise monies to do the work itself.
But as a town committee, they don't have a budget.
But they don't have a budget.
Okay. 200 copies or something.
Yeah.
Town Hall Restoration Committee.
Town Hall Restoration Committee. So we need a...
Don't forget the school meeting too on the 11th, they can have someone there too.
Yep, I think that's the trying to hit all those places.
Well, I said, you know, you said town meeting, I didn't know, you know, they're gonna be for school too.
Nobody goes to a school meeting.
Unfortunately, you're correct, Leo. We have 400 people show up at the town meeting, we only have 50 if we're lucky at the school meeting.
Exactly.
Maybe it'll change.
I hope it does, I really would like to see a school fill up.
$3 in taxes.
I know, I've been telling everybody. I've been telling everybody that.
And I mean, I know they need money, you know, and they need to do work on the school, but I think we need to have more people weigh in on it.
Yeah.
You know?
Exactly.
Whether it passes or not, people need to weigh in.
Bob was at the last meeting, there were six of us.
I went to the one before this, see, unofficial budget committee.
Yeah, right, but there were only six people.
Yeah.
You were able to tape that, right?
Yeah, right.
Oh, speaking of...
The video was not good because the thing was too stiff, everybody moving around. But the audio's good.
The audio is good.
But like I said, nobody, it's like this meeting here, I tell people, there's nothing to watch, it's the audio, so you can have it playing while you're doing something else and listen, you know?
Yeah.
That's what a lot of people do, you know?
Yeah.
Even when I'm up north, I'm busy and I'm listening to you guys right here, you know?
Boy, I would think I'd have more things to do than listen to us.
Sometimes
anyway.
It's a comedy. Yeah, sometimes
we're
you want to turn the music
off. It's a comedy?
Yeah, sometimes it is.
Well, Laurel and Hardy. Yeah, I was going to say Three Stooges, but no. I wasn't going to go there.
Pretty good.
Anything else, Bob?
And the only other thing is, you know, we were talking about the Black History Month, and I'm going to go to some things that are lost in town over time. Mm-hmm. And up on Legate Hill, which is now Rangeway Road on that side, there was a home that my brother and I went and investigated back in the 60s because we missed purchasing that property by one day.
No kidding.
Noise ended up, they sold it to, it was people from New York that owned it, correct?
New York, yeah, right.
But it was an old home, and I can't remember, somebody said who lived there, I can't remember.
Rule?
Because the Rolls used to live on that.
R-U-E-H-L.
Rural.
German.
Yeah. Rural, yeah.
Yeah.
So,
Rolls was
she lives, like actually, the girl that lived there lives in Fred's old house, you know, Fred's father's house.
Yeah.
Fred Mills' father's house on the hill. She lives there now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But in that, we were gone and investigated that house ahead of time to look at it and see what there was. And in that house, you went up this narrow stairway upstairs. They had a rope for a baluster. It was just an old rope that went from the upstairs to downstairs. You went up there, and if you took a panel off where the chimney was, there was a small room in there.
Ooh.
So it probably would have fit in with the Underground Railroad and the Black History Month.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, that house isn't there anymore.
Oh.
Yeah.
You know, and so those are some of the things that as the town grows and things get knocked down and bulldozed or whatever, and you lose it.
Yeah, we lose it.
You know?
That's a shame.
Yeah.
But
progress.
Hopefully, you know, we memorialize it somewhere, like with those that tidbit sheet there, and that's you know good to keep it going best we can.
Yeah.
So. You said you had something else?
Yeah, I had one more thing about the lot.
Oh, I apologize.
I'm also
you upset? Okay.
It was brought up to the attention board that there's the library door is in disrepair.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a security issue. It needs to be addressed probably sooner than later. And I'm not sure. It's the back door into the line.
Yeah, but I thought we did we address that.
No.
I don't think so.
You can almost put your hand through the wood.
All right, something else for me to do.
Yeah, we need the thing is that it,
get a handyman, get a quote.
Right.
Who did our doors here? That was Dave.
Yeah.
Stilson.
Yeah.
I wonder if he'd be interested in doing that one because he's familiar.
It's not a historical door. Leo said to me, he looked at it, he says...
Is it the one going into the library, or is it the one that goes down the cellar?
No, the one into the library, the vestibule, that door.
You can almost actually push your hand through the door.
Yeah, it's that rotted.
And that needs to be, from a security standpoint, that should be fixed sooner than later.
I wonder if they ought to put a... does that have a crash bar on it?
Crash bar does, yes.
Okay.
Yep.
If not, we'd have to make, update it to life safety codes.
It's got a crash bar.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to bring that up, but I guess that was...
Absolutely. I thought it was on the list.
It is on the building maintenance.
I don't think it can wait, though.
Yeah. Okay, that's fine.
Okay, that's all I had. I saw the library trustee, so I... You reminded me, thank you.
You're a library trustee?
No.
No.
Cemetery.
Cemetery. But the thing is, I'm sorry. But still, you reminded me.
Close enough.
Close enough.
We're not that far away.
But the thing is, your presence reminded me of the door, though, for some reason.
Well, stone's throw away.
We'll check it out tomorrow at coffee.
Exactly.
Everybody bring their hammer.
Well, believe me, you could just punch right through it. It's so easy.
Please don't.
No, please don't.
We'll bring a board.
Plastically.
All right, so we're all good up here?
Yes.
Yep.
All right, public comment.
Yeah, yep. Just a comment. The Guinea Road name change.
Yep.
You know, as I stated at the meeting when they brought it up, I'm definitely against that because kind of like what Bob was just saying, you lose parts of your town's history after a while. If it was Maple Street, I guess that'd be a different thing. Or Main Street, that's a different thing. But it would be kind of like if I passed away and they wanted to change the name to my road to my name, you know, it's like, what the hell is that, you know?
Who was that?
Yeah, so, I mean, you know, there's actually historical significance to the name. So just stating that, you know, I'm against that. And the other thing I wanted to mention was John is submitted his resignation as the building inspector.
Mm-hmm. Acting building inspector.
Acting building. But he's going to go back to being the assistant.
He's going
to
retain it. He's currently the assistant building inspector.
Right. So he's going to just drop back to that.
Yeah, he's going
to
just drop back into that.
So does that make him eligible to be the acting building inspector then?
It does, but he doesn't want to do it anymore.
Well, my point is, this is part of his job, so now you can get him right back into it.
I think that the job description for the assistant building inspector was to help out large volume inspections.
Yeah, or cover...
Or vacations or absence, sick days.
Yeah, no, I understand, I was just trying to make light of it.
Yeah, no, I understand where you go. It's kind of that circular argument.
I'm all set, thank you.
All right. Don?
I'm good.
Chief?
Good, thanks. Good.
Came in to take his bride home.
Long drive.
No, I have to take Kim home.
Oh.
Oh. Okay, that's it. No more public comment.
Sorry.
That's okay. I'm kidding. All right. Close public comments, and I don't think we have any non-public or anything of that nature, do we? So I'll entertain a motion to go home.
So moved.
Give a second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen.